So hello everyone, and welcome to our next MIF++ seminar. So today I will be presenting the joint work with Matt Bright and Andy Cooper from our Materials Innovation Factory. So we will be talking about complete isometry invariants of periodic lattices in dimensions 2 and 3. And I will start from dimension 2. So I'm not sure I will actually complete everything, because well, our papers are rather technical and already quite long, but let's start with dimension 2. Okay, so first a general definition. So we are talking about lattices, and formally a lattice is defined by a linear basis. And here the definition is given even in any n-dimensional space, Euclidean space. So a lattice is simply an infinite collection of integer linear combinations of basis vectors with coefficients ci integer numbers. And as you can see from this hopefully familiar picture to you, to many of you, the same lattice can be generated by many different bases, even if you try to choose this basis in a minimal way, so that the unit cell, for example, spanned by our basis has the minimum volume. So even in this case, we have flexibility to shift our points by vector or even rotate a lattice. So get a different basis generating essentially the same lattice. So why the same? So our main motivation to consider lattices up to isometries comes from crystals, because crystal structures are determined in rigid form. That's why it's very natural to study them up to rigid motion. An isometry is a slightly more general concept that also includes reflections in planes in a three-dimensional case. And here for two-dimensional examples, you see rotation, translation, and reflection. So mainly I will talk about isometries, but remember that any orientation preserving isometry can be represented as a rigid motion or as a composition of translations and rotations. Okay, so now the problem. So we are looking for a complete isometry invariant, which is a function from lattices to some numbers. And generally, this problem makes sense in any n-dimensional space. And we'd like this invariant, this function to be invariant, complete, and ideally continuous. So invariance, let me remind you, means that any isometric lattices have the same value of this invariant. So if lambda and lambda dash are isometric, so related by rigid motion or reflection, then the invariant should take the same value. Completeness usually is much harder to satisfy. Completeness means that if an invariant takes the same value on two lattices, then these lattices should be isometric. So it means that our invariant is so strong that it distinguishes all non-isometric lattices. And there are infinitely many non-isometric lattices, so this is really a hard condition. And then continuity. Continuity means that if you perturb our lattice, and usually lattice is given by a basis, so it's natural to measure perturbation in terms of a given basis. So for example, we perturb basis vectors, and our invariant ideally should change also continuously. Yes, with respect to a certain metric on this invariant. So today we'll mainly focus on invariance and completeness, but I will also mention how we are going to produce a continuous metric. Right, two-dimensional case. So our main paper that we were reading, I would say, for more than 3 years now. So we struggled to understand this paper, but now I think we have understood almost everything. So the paper by Conway and Sloan. So it is paper number 6 in a series of 7 papers. Voronoi reduction of three-dimensional lattices. And yes, it's a very interesting paper published nearly 30 years ago. And I think Conway and Sloan, they actually wanted to solve the problem on the previous slide, but they stopped at some point, and hopefully we continue where we stopped about 30 years ago. We actually promised even a four-dimensional case, but I couldn't find any later papers about four dimensions. So two dimensions are simple. So in two dimensions, a lattice is generated by a basis of two vectors, v1, v2, and the key idea, so it's not even the idea of Conway's law. I'm pretty sure it was known to Delaunay earlier, is to consider one extra vector, v0, v0, which is minus v1 minus v2. So we have three vectors, green, blue, and red, and they form a superbase. So three vectors, and we are interested not in arbitrary superbases, we will be interested in obtuse superbases, when all pairwise angles between superbase vectors are obtuse or non-acute, so 90 degrees or more. So on the left-hand side here, you see a generic example. This yellow region is the so-called Voronoi domain. So let me briefly remind the definition. So black dots are our lattice points. And then the Voronoi domain of one point, say the origin simply, so this yellow domain consists, this neighborhood consists of all points that are closer to the origin, non-strictly closer to the origin than to any other lattice points. So that's why this Voronoi domain here is bounded by orthogonal bisectors between the origin and its nearest neighbors. So in the generic case, the origin has six nearest neighbors arranged as here, and the Voronoi domain is hexagonal. The singular case in two dimensions is a rectangular lattice. So in a rectangular lattice, we might have more obtuse superbases. So first let me explain this symmetric picture. So I started from v1, v2, and this red vector v0, right? But we could easily apply the central symmetry, and actually this Voronoi domain is a centrally symmetric hexagon, and get another superbase, which is minus v1 minus v2 and v1 plus v2. So this superbase is centrally symmetric to the first one. In the singular case of rectangular lattice, we also have such a symmetry. For example, this first obtuse superbase, so non-strict because one angle is exactly 90 degrees, this superbase is centrally symmetric to that one, to the third one. But also we have one more. So we have this second, which is not centrally symmetric to the first one, but were related by reflection, right? So they're still isometric. And the final one is again a central symmetry image of the second one. So in two dimensions, it's rather simple. This picture basically explains almost everything, but now let me give more technical details. So first, it's important to prove that any lattice actually has an obtuse superbase. And in dimension three, it is already non-trivial. And in dimension four, I think it is an open problem. At least I haven't seen a proof. So more generally, any lattice, so that theorem was known. So this is a known theorem, any lattice in dimension two or three has an obtuse superbase such that all, so he introduced the new term conorm, which is the negative scalar product or the negative Selin parameter minus vi vj is not negative. So the scalar product itself should be not positive. So every angle is non-acute, obtuse or 90 degrees, but this negative parameter should be positive or zeros. So conorms. And then there are dual objects called Vo norms. So they're even simple. They're simply squared lengths of vectors of our superbase. So V1 squared, V2 squared, V0 squared. And there are very nice relations between Vo norms and conorms here. Well, I have written down them explicitly and even explained how to get them, how to prove. And conversely, of course, we can express conorms Pij in terms of Vo norms. So three numbers in two-dimensional case, three conorms, so three pairwise scalar products are expressible in terms of three Vaux norms. Any questions so far?
Yeah, Vitaly, it's so it's basically we're looking at the Gram matrix, right? So these the Vaux norms would be the diagonal, right? So these are essentially P11, P22, P33, and the others are just dot products between the superbase vectors, right?
You could think in terms of a Gram matrix. So I think our matrices will be even simpler. So here, these equations are written for the two-dimensional case. So we have three numbers and three numbers, okay? So at the moment, they are not arranged in the form of a matrix. Later, I'll put them simply as a triple of numbers, in a row. So even simpler, okay. But you're right, yes. They appear in the Gram matrix. Okay. So I arranged them not in a matrix. And these pictures actually, well, Conway and Sloan didn't have these pictures. These pictures, we introduced them, but they're nice and symmetric. So we considered the so-called Vaux form. So it's a triple of four norms arranged in a triangular cycle. Then there is a dual object called coform. Again, a triangular cycle with vertices labeled by conorms. So it's simply convenient to think about Vaux norms and conorms in a dual way, and that's why we draw them in this dual way. So the name Vaux norm comes from Voronoi. So it's indeed the norm of the squared length of Voronoi vectors. Right, and conorm is a dual object. Then, if you for a simple hexagonal lattice with a minimum interpoint distance a, where Vaux form is very simple, so it has equal values at all vertices, and similarly, coform is very simple, so also equal values but simply different numbers. For a square lattice, you see it's a bit less symmetric, but you see that zero here in the coform appears due to one pair of orthogonal vectors. So we represent graphically Vaux forms and coforms in this way. And so let me make here the main classification statement in two-dimensional case, which is rather simple. But two lattices are isometric if and only if they coforms are related by permutation. So if we allow all isometries, including reflections, when we allow all six permutations of coforms. If we allow only orientation preserving isometries, then we consider only even permutations, so three cyclic permutations of three numbers. Yes. So you see, we have some ambiguity here due to permutation, so that's why it's convenient actually to somehow order them. And so we were thinking about a canonical form and simply called it a root form, so a different name, but it is also convenient to take square roots. Why? Because for any two superbase, we know that our conorms are not negative, so we can easily take the square root, and as a result, the units of these root products will be the same as original coordinates. So if we measure, for example, our unit cells in crystals in angstroms, then root products will be also in angstroms. So that's the reason. And here you see an example where we compare two lattices that differ by reflection. So you see the explicit basis V1, V2, V0, an obtuse superbase for one lattice, orange one, and then the blue lattice on the right hand side, which is simply symmetric with respect to the vertical line. So what do you see? That they root forms, so ordered root products, they differ up to a single transposition. So if we start writing these numbers in the increasing order, so the smallest number is root 3. And then if you would like to keep orientation, we should go say, in the counterclockwise direction. So on the left, if you go from root 3, we have root 3, root 6, root 7. So numbers are increasing. But here we have root 3, root 7, root 6. So a single transposition of two co-norms.
Hey, Vitaly, could I have a question? If I consider all possible isometries, then I'm allowed to do all possible permutations over these two triangles? Or it's just I always apply it to a given triangle, right? So it's basically direct product of two groups, or it's just one single group acting on all numbers here?
Good question. Both ways are correct. So we could fix one triangle and permute numbers in the second triangle only. That's enough. That's enough because we can take compositions of permutations.
Yeah, okay. So, but I mean, permutations are done like in one triangle, then in another triangle. So we don't swap values between the triangles, right? Because they are of different type.
Sure. Yes.
Okay. So we're not. Okay, good.
Right. So the final invariant, which uniquely represents a two-dimensional lattice, is a triple of numbers. So they're written in increasing order if you allow all isometries. If we allow only orientation preserving isometries, then we can start from a minimum number, but then the two other numbers can be swapped or not. So depending on orientation. So please notice that here ordering distinguishes lattices that differ by reflection, and in two dimensions it seems easy, but notice if you take root products of one norms, we get simply distances from the origin to three closest neighbors, right? So these three distances also form an invariant, but these three distances are insensitive to reflections. So they do not distinguish lattices up to reflection. That's why here we are a little bit more careful, and this difference will be much more important in the three-dimensional case. Okay, let me, metric, yes. So how now to actually define a distance between lattices? So here, Vladimir, see, I take a minimum over permutations applied to one root form. So that's enough. But in principle, you could also minimize over permutations of both root forms. So root form is a triple of numbers. So we consider it as a vector in R3. And in principle, we could take any metric on R3. So it could be Euclidean metric, Minkowski metric, L1, L infinity, or in principle N. But when we minimize this distance taken on two three-dimensional vectors, minimize over all permutations of one root form. So the permutation here acts on our three-dimensional vector. And if you'd like to preserve orientation, then of course we should take only even permutations, so cyclic permutations in this case. So what we have proved, and in two dimensions, it's easy enough, that all metric axioms hold. And also we have a bicontinuity, which means that we represented lattices considered up to isometry by these root forms, so triples of numbers. So R of L here are root forms of lattices, and we have a bijection between triples of numbers, not negative. And all isometry classes use superbases. And for example, will the L infinity metric on these superbases minimize all the rotations? So if you perturb our superbase a little bit, then our root products will be perturbed a little bit, and vice versa. Question?
Yeah. Sorry, I lost the second triangle because here you do permutation in one of them, but we have two triangles. I don't know. I kind of. So root form would include information only about one of the triangles, or?
Of course.
Yeah.
So we have one lattice lambda. Its superbase consists of three vectors, so we have three scalar products. Three products arranged into a triangle cycle into one root form.
But I had but we had this triangle in the pointing upwards and triangle pointing downwards.
So these are dual.
Because we can recompute one from another, so we need only one.
Exactly. In two dimensional case, it's actually it's actually doesn't matter. So instead, we could consider waveforms. But in three dimensions, it will be much more convenient to work with coforms. So that's why, for consistency, we consider only coforms. Okay. So nice triangle. So this waveform. So it's V from Voronoi. Okay. And coform is a standard triangle. In convex Sloan, it's actually opposite, but we decided to change pictures.
Okay. Good. Yeah.
Okay.
So why is it easier to use coforms for three dimensions?
You will see. You will see the three-dimensional case a bit later, Marcin. Okay, so this slide summarizes what we have done in two dimensions. So as a summary, so we started from lattices considered up to isometry. Now this lattice isometry space is complicated. Well, already in dimension two, so it wasn't completely trivial. In dimension three, it will be much more interesting. So it's a complicated space, and the past problem was that a lattice can be represented by many bases or many super bases if you add one more vector. So we could change a basis, we could apply an isometry, so there were a lot of ambiguity here. But reduction theorem, so there was known reduction theorem to reduce any basis to a super base. So unfortunately, there is still some ambiguity here. So these pictures here show the remaining ambiguity. It's easy. So central symmetry in a generic case and reflections for rectangular lattice. So we remove this ambiguity, replace or representing an obtuse superbase now by its root form. So root form is an order triple of numbers. So for a square lattice, say 0, 1, 1. For a hexagonal lattice, 3 equal numbers. And these root forms are unique and complete invariants. So the main result can be stated as follows. So we had rather complicated space, lattice isometry space, and now it is represented in a very simple numerical form. So triples of numbers with a well-defined metric on them. Any other questions about two dimensions? Okay, so if there are no questions about two dimensions, then let's go to the three-dimensional case, and I'll actually start from the summary because it's similar. But it's not a summary, it's a plan, right? Since we are starting. So the problem is similar. The problem is we have lattices considered up to isometry, and here it's an example where I simply have chosen a different basis. So we could change a basis for the same lattice, we could also rotate, and then even for that simple cubical lattice, I actually struggled to recognize what it is, the same cubical lattice after rotation, even with a small number of points. So there is a reduction theorem. So we will get, we will come to obtuse superbases similarly, but here the situation will be much more interesting. And this is like a novelty, that obtuse superbases are much more variable for three-dimensional lattices. So here I actually briefly show an example. So for a cubic lattice, one obtuse superbase is easy. So you take the standard of orthogonal bases, so red, green, blue, and then the vector minus v1, minus v2, minus v3, which is diagonally opposite. And of course, you could reflect, rotate, that simple. But also there is another superbase here, which is not isometric to this one. And here you see two standard basis vectors, green and blue, but then two other vectors, red and orange. So they are not diagonal. Their length, they are not big diagonals. Their length is root two. So they are actually small diagonals, but nonetheless, all pairwise angles are non-acute here. So that's why it will be much more interesting. Okay, so let's start again with waveforms and coforms. So if you have an obtuse super base and this reduction theorem was known, so now we have four vectors in a three-dimensional case. We have v1, v2, v3, and v0 is minus v1, minus v2, minus v3. Or symmetrically, we could say that the sum of all four vectors is exactly zero vector. Then this obtuse super base has now 7 Vaux norms. So why 7? So geometrically, it will be clear a bit later. But what are they? So we could take squared lengths of these original vectors, but we also take a squared lengths of sums vi plus vj. Well, you might ask, how about say vk plus vl? So another pair. Well, vk plus vl actually has exactly the same squared length, exactly because the sum of 4 equals 0. So you have 7 Vaux norms. So this is the definition. So we define them here. And 6 conorms. So 6 pairwise scalar products with the negative sign. And yeah, later we will use root products. So now we arrange them Vaux norms in the following triangle. So it's a bit more complicated here. So it is, well, I wouldn't call it a graph. So it's actually a bit more complicated. It's the projective plane of degree 2 of Fano plane. Well, which is rather hard to explain, but consider them simply as seven nodes or 7 numbers arranged in triples. So you can see with triples. So there are sides of these triangles, so there are these lines, and also there is that circle, which is also considered as a line in that projective plane of degree 2. An interesting remark about this Vaux form is the following, that the sum of these 4 numbers equals the sum of that 3 numbers. And yeah, there is more symmetry, so I explained earlier, right? But v2 plus v3 squared actually equals v0 plus v1 squared. So there is a lot of symmetry. So that's Vaux form, but mainly we will use a coform. Well, which is easier because it has 6 conorms and 0. And that 0 was actually a very hard obstacle for us to understand. But so we have more details in the paper, but right now I could briefly explain why we have 0 here. Because as you can expect, of course, we could compute Vaux norms via conorms and vice versa. But we have 7 numbers on the left, 6 numbers on the right, plus this linear relation. So this linear relation explains why there is a bijection between them. So 7 numbers with linear relation are equivalent to 6 numbers without any relations. And that's why we have 0 here. So basically this 0 is simply the difference. So that sum minus that sum. Yeah, there is a more technical formula, but hopefully I explained why you have 0 here. Okay, now if you have an obtuse super base, this is a tuple of 4 vectors. So 4 vectors, and we could easily permute one, right? If you permute vectors, we get the same lattice, right? But the computed Vaux form and coform might be different. And here we show differences. So what happens if you swap vectors 1 and 2? Well, if you wish, you could look at Vaux forms, but if you would like to make your life easier, focus only on coforms, so on standard triangles. If you swap vectors 1 and 2, then in terms of indices, it's very simple. So you simply swap indices 1 and 2. For example, here we had 1, 3, and on the next picture we have 2, 3, right? So we simply swap 1 and 2. Easy to understand. Swapping 0 and 1 in terms of indices is exactly the same. So let's look at P13. P13, we swap 0 and 1, so now we have P03, right? Now, how to make sense of these 6 numbers? Yeah, instead of Gram matrix, we here write a simpler 2x3 matrix. So the top row corresponds to these internal nodes. Well, Well, standard triangle is actually in the middle. So that's the standard one. So P2' P1' P1'2. So we well, you might ask, well, why do we start with P2'? Well, we decided to make our main row the bottom row. So in the bottom row, I hope the ordering is natural. So P01, P02, P03, natural ordering of indices. And when indices in the top row are fixed, so P01 is opposite to P23 in this coform. So that's why we're written in columns here. Okay. So opposite conons correspond to each other. So P01, P02, P03. So we're vertices of this coform. And opposite conons, they are in the same column. Okay. So what happens under these transpositions of indices? So one and two is easier to understand. One and two means simply that we swap columns one and two in that 2x3 matrix. Right. So you see this column goes to the second place, the second column goes to the first place here. So two columns are swapped. The transposition 0, 1 is a bit more complicated. So 0, 1 means what we have with cross diagonal swap. So these two numbers are swapped and these two numbers are swapped. Right. So 0, 1 are fixed. So we fix that column and swap diagonally two other pairs. Okay. So here we demonstrated two transpositions, but of course, with transpositions and one more, 2, 3, they generate 4 factorial, 24 permutations of 4 basis vectors. Right. So it means that permuting basis vectors now generates sort of isomorphism between coforms. So we need to consider our coforms up to at least 24 isomorphism, or we call them index permutations. So this is actually the most generic case. There will be more singular cases a bit later. Yes. So the idea here is from obtuse super bases, we would like to extract numerical invariants, similarly to the two-dimensional case. And if you simply look at our coform, so this coform is a bit more complicated. So 2x3 number, 2x3 matrix. In two dimensions, we had only a triple, right? Three numbers, so much easier. But now it's 2x3. And permutations are more complicated. So we cannot arbitrarily permute all 6 conorms. No, we have only 4 factorial, 24 permutations. Now, but this is only the first step. So to get an invariant, what do we need? We need to be sure that any obtuse super base leads us to the same numerical value of an invariant. So first obstacle, if you have an obtuse super base, then there is actually one more. So it's similar to the two-dimensional case. We can take the symmetric image. So minus V0, minus V1, minus V2, minus V3. It's also a perfect super base. All pairwise angles are obtuse. As you can see easily, the coform is the same. So nothing changes, no permutations even are needed. So that's good. Next step, if obtuse super bases are isometric. So imagine this picture actually shows one isometry. So we have two fixed basis vectors and the green vector here is reflected from the right position to the left position. This is an isometry, and of course, the orange vector of the diagonal is also reflected as a result. So these two super bases were isometric, and in the isometry of the coform is also preserved. Well, simply because scalar products, so lengths, everything is preserved under isometry. So excellent so far. But we notice that a cube, well, more generally, any rectangular box, a cuboid in terms of in Voronoi terms, it has at least 8 isometric obtuse super bases. Are there any more? Because if there is another super base, then we should check whether this different, potentially different super base leads us to the same invariant value. because we're interested in invariants. Okay, and now we come to the main difficulty here, or the main, well, challenge of the three-dimensional life. So in two dimensions, Voronoi domains were simple, a centrally symmetric hexagon or a rectangle. In three dimensions, this theorem by George Voronoi is much more complicated. So there are five types. Yeah, cuboid is simple. It's simply a rectangle lattice, but well, the most generic case is called a truncated octahedron with seven pairs of opposite parallel faces. And now the key question, which we couldn't find any answer in the past. I hope that there are several experts in the audience in computational geometry. So if you know anything about this question, please let us know. So what obtuse superbases can we have in three-dimensional lattices? Right, so five types, so there will be five lemmas. So I'm not going to prove the lemmas, but hopefully I state all of them. So hopefully statements will be understandable and I'll try to explain. So the first case is actually the easiest in a sense. So if you have a generic lattice of type V1, then it has only two obtuse superbases, well, two centrally symmetric. So by the reduction theorem, we know that one superbase exists for sure. Then there is one more when we take minus. And it is actually non-trivial to prove that there is no other apart from these two. Because Voronoi domain is complicated. So it's, it has seven pairs of opposite faces. So what does it mean? It means that we have seven pairs of opposite Voronoi vectors. So 14 vectors in total. And in principle, well, 14 vectors around the origin, there are many choices, potential choices for an obtuse superbase. Many choices among 14. So this is a non-trivial, geometrically completely non-trivial statement, but there are only two. So if there is one, then there is only one more and nothing else. So how we prove it? So the idea for this lemma and actually all subsequent lemmas is to use the theorem from Conway-Sloan. I think it is actually stated and proved in all dimensions, but it's not, well, it's only one step, first step. So for any obtuse superbase, so here stated in three dimensions, the partial sums, so when we take sums of Voronoi vectors, sums of what superbase vectors, these partial sums, they are necessarily Voronoi vectors. Strict Voronoi vectors in this generic case, but the theorem is more general. So they could be non-strict in further singular cases. And these Voronoi vectors are normal to opposite parallel faces. That's why it's actually enough to consider these 14 vectors and search among these 14 vectors. But it is still a challenge. Okay, so that's the first lemma. Second type. So it's called hexarhombic dodecahedron. So I'm not drawing it. It's complicated, but we have now a non-strict obtuse superbase. So you remember that all scalar products should be non-negative. In the previous case, were all strictly positive, but now we have one singularity. One scalar product is exactly zero. And this zero scalar product leads us to one more superbase, different from that one. I mean, not centrally symmetric. So that's the superbase. And simply looking at these vectors, you might realize that lengths of these vectors might be different from lengths of these vectors. So these two superbases may not be isometric. They might be different. So here I have written the co-forms, and so this zero comes of course from that scalar product p1 2 equals zero. So what's the difference in co-forms? In principle, co-forms could be very different, but luckily, so in this case the difference is very simple. We swap these two co-norms. Well, you might ask, so why with two? It looks a bit non-symmetric. Well, actually everything here is symmetric. So first of all, if you you notice the symmetry here with indices, when we swap indices 1 and 2, right? So if you swap vectors v1, v2, yeah, everything is preserved, and you could check what the, well, this basis is preserved, and this one actually maps to its opposite, to its centrally symmetric image. So all these index swaps are very natural here. But also remember that apart from this transposition of, well, rather strange conorms, we have 24 index permutations. So this extra transposition should be considered in combination with the previously known 24 permutations. And then it becomes much more symmetric, because previously 24 transpositions were kept all numbers in columns. So if you had a pair in one column, then it remained in one column. So that column could go to a different place, but it could go, well, like that, but still the same column. Here we actually we make a single diagonal swap. So it means like P01 is no longer in the same column with P23, right? But applying more index permutations allow us to make, for example, this swap. So this swap is also okay if you permute indices. So that's why the symmetry is here is very natural. Okay, next case. V3 lattice. So it is still rather complicated. It is a rhombic dodecahedron. And now we have one more degeneracy. We have one pair of orthogonal vectors and another pair. V1, V2, V0, V3. So different pair, two pairs of orthogonal vectors. In that case, we have three. We have three obtuse superbases. So more exactly, any obtuse superbase is isometric to one of these. And I'm writing down the coforms. So these zeros, of course, come from this orthogonal vectors. And so notice what happens. We permute any conorms here, P01 remains fixed. It might look a bit non-symmetric, but remember, so 0, 1, yes, if we could, so 0, 1 and 2, 3 here, well, can be swapped. And also remember about index permutations. So we could permute vectors, and these index permutations can move P01 in any position. So we simply allow more permutations in addition to the previous 24. So basically we allow all possible permutations of these four numbers if you allow a change of orientation. So all four conorms can be permuted here. Okay, so that case is easier, V4. Because the Voronoi domain here is a hexagonal prism. And hexagonal prism, so it means a monoclinic lattice in crystallographic terms. But remember the generic two-dimensional case. In the generic two-dimensional case, we had a hexagon for a Voronoi domain. So now we simply multiply this hexagon by an orthogonal vector. So here we have V1, which is orthogonal to both V2 and V3. So one orthogonal vector and, say, vertical one, and a generic lattice in two dimensions, okay? In this case, we have more. So we have more potential superbases. So 5 are written here. So these are all the coforms. And you might notice what happens, well, with P01. With P01, nothing happens, so it stays, Let me explain. You could consider it staying in the same place. So why? Because the original 24 index permutations will allow us to swap these two zeros in the top row with two numbers in the bottom row. So we could actually put these two zeros on the bottom row easily by swapping vectors. And when we have the bottom row P0100, right? So if you do a similar swap in that example, or in this example, then you will see that P01 is with two zeros in the bottom row. So that's a common feature in all coforms. So P01 here is a bit separate from others, but all others can be permuted. So, but P01 is separate. Okay, and the final case, well, maybe the simplest, but in a sense, most interesting. So cuboid, so you have an orthogonal lattice, orthogonal basis V1, V2, V3. Then any obtuse superbase of that orthogonal lattice is isometric to one of the following two classes. So we call them odd superbases and even superbases. So odd superbases are standard. So these are, well, three standard orthogonal vectors here. So you could change signs, but the opposite vector is simply the longest diagonal. So if these vectors have length 1, 1, 1, then this vector has length root 3. And the coform is easy. So three zeros coming from three pairwise orthogonal vectors and three non-zeros, simply squared lengths in the bottom row. But there is another class of obtuse superbases, which we call even, and they have this form. So Vi, Vj, Vk here, they could be any, they are taken, well, from this family. So plus minus V1, plus minus V2, plus minus V3. And in this case, the coform looks differently. So it's not three zeros in the top row. With three zeros, two zeros in one column and one zero is somewhere else. So that's a difference. That's a difference. However, since the case is simple enough, you notice that everything here is defined actually by three numbers, by each lens of our unit cell, or by lens, right? So we could keep with numbers and this will be enough. So let me see. I'll move a bit quickly. So similarly to the two-dimensional case, we would like to resolve all this ambiguity of coforms which allow too many permutations and define a canonical object which we similarly called root form. So we are taking root products, of conorms, and then root form in this case for a cuboid is simply the triple of numbers, yes, which can be written in increasing order. Well, this might even sound absolutely obvious for you. If you'd like to compare two rectangular lattices, then of course it's enough to compare two triples ordered. And indeed, so this lemma 5 was important because we know that there is nothing else coming from coforms. Well, these three numbers could be extracted from coforms, and any lattices of this type are isometric if and only if they have the same three ordered numbers. Okay, that case was simple, and yeah, to make the talk a bit more interesting, let me show these three numbers projected to a triangle, and these numbers come from about 145,000 primitive or four-rhombic lattices in crystals from the Cambridge structural database. So we have three numbers. Well, we call them ABC, or we call them R01, R02, R03. So these three numbers, they define a point in a positive octant. So and this positive octant can be projected to the standard simplex on vertices 1 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 1, so that equilateral triangle. And then we also have a symmetry because we can permute with three numbers. That's why here you see not the full triangle, but 1/6 of this triangle. And what you notice, so this is a density plot. So every pixel here represents, the color represents how many lattices we have with this particular root forms. So it actually shows that even in this very restrictive class, primitive or four-rhombic lattices, almost everything is possible among the real crystals. So almost the whole triangle is filled apart from this region at the bottom, which is simply explained that atoms cannot be very close to each other. So of course, some parameters cannot be close to zero. That's it, but everything else is possible. So the whole triangle here is filled without any gaps. Okay, after this practical digression, let me move to the V4 lattice. So it is a hexagonal prism for a Voronoi domain. Then we have two zero co-norms. And up to our index permutations, we could put them in the bottom row. So P01 now becomes distinguished. So we have only four numbers. And instead of considering these co-forms up to many, many permutations, we simply write these four numbers in the following form. So R01 is separate. And these three numbers are in increasing order. That's it, because we have enough permutations to permute one. And these permutations come from our understanding of obtuse superbases for any hexagonal prism. So this is non-trivial. V3 lattice. So in that case, we have two zeros in one column. And if you allow a change of orientation, then all four numbers can be permuted. So we have enough permutations to realize all of them. That's why there is no point to write them in a matrix form. We could simply write them as a quadruple in increasing order to remove any ambiguity. So the root form of V3 lattice consists of these four numbers. V2 lattice, a co-form has exactly one zero. We have five numbers, five root products. P03 is clearly distinguished because it is in the same column. So that column will stay. So no permutations can move P03 away from zero. It will stay with zero. That's why this number is separate. And something actually is preserved here as well. So in the previous case, we had the freedom to permute all four, not here. So here we keep with diagonal pairs. So P23 remains diagonal to P02. That's why we put them into one pair, and then this pair also this pair remains diagonal under all index under all permutations. So you have five numbers, but split into three groups. So 2 plus 2 plus 1. So in every pair, we can write down them in increasing order as usual, and pairs can be swapped, but we can write down them lexicographically to get again a unique root form. And finally, the most generic case, when all co-norms are non-zeros, then we keep it as a matrix. We keep it as a 2 by 3 matrix, but index permutations allow us to order. So we decided to order the top row, put the top row in increasing order. And in that case, there is a little bit of freedom to try to order the bottom row, but very little, unless we have again singular cases, singular in the sense that two co-norms are equal. So if two co-norms in the top row are equal, then there is a more flexibility to make it a bit more canonical. So we are trying to order the bottom row also in the increasing order. Right, so actually very good. So I have about 5 more minutes, and yes, there is no time to discuss metrics. However, I outline the idea. Outline the idea that comes from recent examples we have discussed with Larry Anderson, Herbert Bernstein. So very useful examples. So imagine the hierarchy. We have V1 at the top, the most generic truncated octahedron. Then V1 goes to V2, so it degenerates to a hexarhombic dodecahedron. Then we split. We have either rhombic dodecahedron or hexagonal prism, so two different classes, and they again come back to a cuboid. So that's a hierarchy of Voronoi types. And now to compare root forms, so we need to be a bit careful. So of course we could write down root forms as 2x3 matrix and consider index permutations, but you have seen there are more potential permutations. That's why to compare any arbitrary root forms, well, in the simple form we have discussed, say triples, quadruples, etc., or in a matrix form, we need to check if these two lattices have a common closest neighbor, closest lattice one level below, because they could be. So a good illustration, I think, is, let me see. So I don't have a specific slide, but I think I could illustrate it here. So imagine that we change the zero to a small positive number, say epsilon. Then we have a generic case, right? And in the generic case, we have only 24, so it's standard index permutations, and these swaps are not allowed. But now imagine for one lattice, this epsilon goes to zero, so it becomes zero. And now we have an extra permutation. We have an extra permutation, and the resulting coform might look very different from this one up to standard permutations. Right? So that's why this original 24 permutations for small positive numbers instead of zeros are not enough. We need to consider a common closest neighbor. So that we go from a lattice, say lambda, to a neighbor, lambda dash, and then back to our second lattice, lambda double dash. Actually, to satisfy the triangle inequality here. So we should take the minimum. So we should take the minimum over all potential nearest neighbors one level below. Well, you might think this is difficult, but we are dealing actually with numbers. So the most complicated case is in front of us. So we have five numbers. So we are looking for a common closest neighbor represented by five numbers, comparing these five numbers with six numbers and another six numbers. So for at least for the Euclidean metric, this is a quadratic optimization, so it can be solved explicitly. So five linear equations with five unknown variables. So that's why we are confident that we can define the metric as expected. Right. So yeah, let me finish indeed before 3 o'clock. Let me stop recording, and then we'll have a discussion.